This is an Octave Higher, a weekly exposé of Jamaican musical talents from a unique angle. Some may even say the right angle. From the men and women who continue to compose, perform, and produce music we have become so attached to. An Octave Higher pays tribute to these musical heroes that you won't necessarily see behind a microphone or on the front page of an album cover, but you have been enjoying their talents and creativity over the years. Thanks for joining us as we delve into the mind and all a reason with another fine Jamaican musician. Welcome. It's time to take you an octave higher.
Welcome to another edition of An Octave Higher. It's the kind of program that takes a look at the genius behind the hit songs. Of course, you know, you'll always have the great vocalists, but oftentimes we tend not to focus on the great musicians. And An Octave Higher will give you an insight into the minds and the life of these great individuals. And today, sharing with us is none other than Mr. Patrick Kitson. Listen to me, man. If you don't know the name, you're going to know the name by the time we're done. You understand? Let me just say, change here, man. Patrick.
Yes, sir.
Wagwan.
We're there, man. We're
it's
there.
An honor, yes, and a man. Privilege, brethren, to come and sit down in your space. Yes.
I tell you.
I share with you.
Yes, man. Great to have you guys here, man.
Yes.
Yep.
You know, I only know Patrick from the perspective of a musician. I've heard the great compositions from the group Change. And I'm going to stop beat the music there now. But when I walk into this man's space, people, I want the camera to take a pan at some point and show you the magnificence of the artwork by this man, Patrick Kitson. If you never knew his talent before, you're going to know today.
Yikes.
An artist beyond compare. Trust me. Patrick, like Jamaicans always say, you're body now, yeah.
We give thanks. We give thanks for the gifts, man. Yeah,
man. Really, really stirring pieces that I'm seeing here. It's pretty similar to your music, man.
Yes. I kind of bring it from the art to the music and from the music to the art. So lots of intricacies and details and stuff like that. And of course, in the middle of doing art, you know, I have my guitar is usually out, so I need to take a break.
You know? Strum on your Eric Clapton guitar. Yo, that me talk it and leave the man yard alone. All right, don't come here and feel so no want a souvenir and go touch his Betsy.
That's right.
Understand? Don't do it.
That's right. That's
how did you get involved in music though, Patrick?
As far back as I can remember, my parents, you know, my father was always a pastor. And I think I born comes to a guitar in the house.
Yes.
So, you know, I used to pick a little one tune and stuff. And I think it's from there it started. From maybe about 5 or 4, some, you know, singing at church from a sit down, stand up on the chair.
Yes.
Yeah, so that, a couple years ago that.
And your love for the art was birthed out of that experience, just growing up around that.
Oh yes. I remember, like, my brothers used to draw. I'm the last child, the wash belly type of thing.
Right.
So, big brothers, and you know, you have them to be your role models and stuff. So, I used to see my brothers drawing. So, I just follow what they're doing. You know, them playing the guitar. Maybe sometimes I take it up in a tune, but, you know, I still pick my little one tune. And I remember one day my brother taught me to do this song. It was a choir song, "The Lord Send Down an Angel to Tell His Servant John." And that, you know, yeah. And you could have picked that on the guitar every day,
yes.
You know. Until daddy bought me a guitar. I was maybe about 10. And, you know, my brother came home, saw the guitar, showed me a couple chords on it, and I just go to church and every song I play another one card. Yeah. But I was exposed early. It seemed like I really loved it. The church where daddy was first, I think it was on 12th Street in Trenchtown. And I figured that was the street that Bob Marley lived on.
Yes.
And I was, yeah, I was still in single digits. So maybe could be five. And that time the guitar used to come through the steel horn.
Yeah.
On the outside. And there was this brother and the sound good. All everything in there just sounded good. Can't remember, maybe brother Danny Gala or something like that. And I think the whole trench tone maybe used to hear him. And he just stayed with me. Went to another church, still in Trenchtown, and Otis Wright, the late great Otis Wright, attended that church, and that church was like a super church, you know, big church, and the music was always live. Otis became a Sunday school teacher. So as a little youth, to sit down and watch all these guys playing guitar and singing and stuff, I said, oh, this right. So, you know, you see him old, like the A card, I'm like, oh, that's how it go on. Yeah.
Catching fire.
Yep, yep. And I was always into it. Never stop.
So that followed you through your youth, growing up into your adult years.
Oh, yes.
You actually decided that you want to pursue music in a big way.
I don't know if I, well.
Or is it that you fell into it?
Yeah, I fell into it. I'm self-taught. I can't read music. I try reading music, and it just not make no sense to me. I couldn't understand it. So I say, all right, but I must love this guy that I go mix up what I'm hearing. So most of the thing I hear is maybe not from the books.
Yes.
You know, but.
We interpret it and express it.
Yep. So I'm sorry, I couldn't read and learn and play like some people. You know, but some things kind of unique to me. So we just run with it and stay connected to the source.
Yeah.
So when the father, you know, he might say, yo, go and do that, man, you know. I remember years ago when I met Andre Crouch and I sat in the hotel room with him. Him can't read music.
Interesting.
Yeah, him can't read music. He said he used to see music in colors. So I refer to this like blue and red and stuff. So I never feel so bad, so I can't read music, but yeah.
You know, so it's interesting that you mentioned the whole matter of colors, because I've heard that expression before, that people experience sound in different shades or colors. But it's the first time I hear that one of our icons in music is admitting that's how he interprets music.
Yeah, and I'm like, okay, I'm all right then, man, if me can't read it, but I hear things, yes. So I'm in good hands, man.
Indeed.
Yes.
Now, I know, I want to find out more about you and the artwork, because I'm sure it's not something that you pick up after you put on music. I'm sure this is something that you've been doing pretty much all your life as you've been doing music.
Oh yes, I, as far back as I can remember, I am drawing.
Yeah.
Of course, daddy encouraged it. He would buy the pencil and, you know, the books and stuff. And he used to tell me, well, I think my brothers, our daddy used to say, when I, you know, them have to take the pencil away from me.
Yeah.
As a little boy. And I go sleep with the pencil.
Yes.
And they took it away. But I was always drawing. And then funny enough, like a primary school friend of mine, and I'm put up on Facebook, and he reminded me of a poem that I put a tune.
Are you serious?
To in primary school, yes. And is this. I'm just a little pencil that made of wood and lead. My head is long and pointed. My body is smooth and red. And I just decided to sing it, you know.
So you remember the song?
I remember.
So sing the song, no man. Why?
No, the two I. I'm just a little pencil that made of wood and lead. My head is long and pointed, my body is smooth and red. I once was long and handsome, and now I soon must die. I like to write quite nicely, but master does not try. And some of that, I mean, that was, and he remembered it. I'm like, yes, I remember doing that. So I used to sing it in the class,
yes.
You know, yeah, man. And then, you know, growing up and you learning songs, if it never suit what I was singing,
I rearrange it.
Yes, and that was, and there was one such song, I used to sing it as a little boy. You can't go to heaven in a miniskirt and all that. And there's
that
some
changed now.
Which was very popular, you know, yes. You know, rallies and programs, and that was my little tune. And you know, add some verses to it, some lines and stuff. So I'm always changing up the thing, man.
Excellent. We're gonna take a break right now. I mean, we're here sitting reasoning with Patrick Kitson. Musician, artist, artist as well. It's all about an octave higher. We're going to be bringing you a little bit more right after this short break.
Do you have a product or service to advertise? Or do you wish to become a sponsor of this program, An Octave Higher? Then please call the number on the screen, 876-831-3042, or email anoctavehigher79@gmail.com. We look forward to partnering with you in developing this new reality TV concept, an entertaining discussion program interspersed with spontaneous, delightful performances.
Why you playing? What you playing? Sounds real good. An octave higher. Welcome back to An Octave Higher. And it's the program that takes a deeper look at the genius behind the hit songs, the famous songs, the fun songs, the music that you so enjoy. With me today is the man Patrick Kitson, great artist, great musician. And I'm going like in shy. Oh, you have to have a great star.
Yeah.
And man, we're sitting in a hotel room with Andre Crouch and have a Eric Clapton guitar. No, you can't classify you as anything else but great. And you wear the signature hat again. Yeah, that's what my hat there. Nah, next time we get that. Patrick.
Yes, man.
I mean, you were composing from your childhood years, mm-hmm. but you've been involved in some groups. Some gospel groups that have impacted the local gospel music scene in a significant way. Tell me about your foray into the groups. You started off with Insight?
It was before Insight. My brother had a group that was called the Ransom Singers.
The Ransom Singers,
right? Yes, and right. I used to play the guitar. In those days, you just go around and the guitar and back up everybody.
Yeah.
So that was good for me. And from those days, you know, then I would pay attention to the songs they used to sing and, you know, make the adjustment where necessary.
Yeah.
And then after that, Insights. I was 14.
14?
14 when I was asked by Dennis Haynes to join Insights Gospel Group. Oh, God. It was a dream come true. I was like a 14-year-old boy, yeah. You know, you get playing a band, and Insights was fairly popular.
Band of the day.
Yes, Insights started out of another group that is gospel-like band. So most of the members from Insights came out of that group.
Yeah.
And gospel-like band was still going on, and then Insights Gospel Group. So that was great for me, and I had the opportunity to play with like the great Lennox Gordon, Andel Foggy was on drum, and Tony Hutton was on bass, and of course a little teenager boy Patrick Kitson on rhythm guitar. And it was just awesome. I learned a lot, and what I liked about Insights. Insights would not do the popular songs of the day. Ah. Yeah, so that was very encouraging for me. So I, you know, listened to the arrangement and, you know, them writing the songs. And so even if they choose a song that is popular,
They made it their own.
Yes. Yeah. So that is in my culture, it's in my DNA. So even now, sometimes I hear some people, I do some people's song, you know. So
rub it around.
Yes. I can't manage it. I tell them, say, just blame it on my introduction into the music.
Yes.
So from an early age and stage in that group, I started to make my little contribution, you know, listen to songs. And I said, Dennis, you know, I hear the song. And... you know, and then I would go by Dennis and would be writing songs and, you know. So that was my introduction into really getting into writing songs.
So let me ask you, man, you've written a lot of songs over the years.
It seems so.
But you have not recorded a lot of these songs, have you?
Not a lot of the, well, some insights were recorded. Highway to Heaven. Yes, that was my little idea. Because that was written when I was in high school. And we used to add a little DJ part to it.
Yeah.
So that DJ part changed every year or every month as the secular DJ things change, then we would use that idea. So you don't know what to expect when you hear Highway to Heaven. So that run like maybe about 15 years, you know, and stuff. And a lot of the songs, he was one on inside, Satan, you're a wanted man, you know.
That good old memory, coming up, man. I tell you. Listen, man, fast forward to the genesis of Change.
Okay.
How did that come about? And how instrumental were you in that group?
Change started out of Insights.
See
that. 5 members, Insights had 6 person at the time, 6 members, and 5 of us went and started Change. It was my idea.
Yes.
I kind of was having some issues. I was like, why let us, you know, so we started out and we brought in a female lead singer. So the songs Change used to perform came out of Inside. So We Have a Message and all of those songs were like in the last days of Inside when we started to change this thing now and start to focus a lot more on reggae music. So a lot of those songs. Okay, most of the songs that changed, all the songs that changed used to perform in the early days came out of Insights. Yeah. And Insights was myself, Rowan Reed, Lloyd Geddes was on drum, Mark James on keyboard, and Merle Gale, who used to sing with Grace Trillers as a lead singer. She joined and spent a little time with us, and then Anthony Barnes, who was also a lead singer from Grace Trillers. Or
they would
no, they would leave. They would leave. But yeah, so Change was an awesome experience for me, man.
It was a change. Yeah?
Oh yes,
a big change.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. And I would want to say that to a great extent, Change revolutionized the approach to gospel music in Jamaica.
Oh yes.
To the chagrin of many, but. Over time, that form of expression has become more accepted.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time and effort doing reggae music.
Yes.
We had that conviction and covering because an important, interesting thing with Change was that like maybe 5 of the members were pastors' kids.
Yes.
So we never have that little, you know, although there were some little, they weren't accepting it readily, but we did all right.
Yes.
Because we know, say, you know, we cover and your mother pray for you. And, you know, them glad to see you play music in a church. So it wasn't an issue. So we put a lot of emphasis. And it's now you're kind of hearing who you had influence on all these musicians.
Indeed.
I said, boy, Patrick, you know, remember me a little boy? I used to watch you, you know, and boy, I study all them things. And interesting journey, man. Interesting.
Who are the members in Change up to the point where the group cease to record and perform together?
The lead singer was Angel Lawrence, Michael Kennedy bass, Othney Lewis, keyboard, John Sharp, keyboards, and Bobby Stewart, drums.
All right.
Yeah, that was a powerful aggregation.
I'm telling you. And all of the names that you call are still active.
Very active.
At this point, you know. Yes. I'm hoping for a change reunion one of these days.
Yeah, it should be happening, hopefully, hopefully.
All right, we're going to take a break right now. We'll change up the thing right now. Well, when we come back, definitely we're going to find out about the artist. You know, the man behind the drawings. The youngster who fell asleep with a pencil. All right? We'll soon come back.
Do you have a product or service to advertise? Or do you wish to become a sponsor of this program, An Octave Higher? Then please call the number on the screen, 876-831-3042, or email anoctavehigher79@gmail.com. We look forward to partnering with you in developing this new reality TV concept, an entertaining discussion program interspersed with spontaneous, delightful performances.
Why you playing? What you playing? Sounds real good. An octave higher. Welcome back to An Octave Higher. Me and Patrick Kitson in his personal space. And that's the thing about An Octave Higher, you know, people. When I'm in a studio, we are going and go pretty up the thing, you know. We are going in a demanding creative space. You understand? Because that's where the magic happens. And we're sharing with the great Patrick Kitson, great musician, great artist, and great artist. Fell asleep with a pencil. But before you tell me about you and the pencil and all of your artwork, Bridget, quick o'clock, as them say.
Yeah.
Give me a quick rundown of some of the songs that you've written, recorded, for yourself and for different people.
Okay, in Insights, the first recording is a song that's called Jesus Christ, I Love You. That was like a rock steady song. I did lead sing on that song as a teenager. And Highway to Heaven, that was my composition. Couple more, I don't remember. Unchanged. Most of the songs and all the songs on Change's album, I would have writer's credit. There's some that I would share, but there's We Have a Message, Taste and See, Everywhere We Went, Jesus is Lord, Can't Take Your Love Away. Yeah.
You've written some other people as well.
Yes, when Juna Tucker got saved, you know, because Juna will tell you that Change was influential with his coming to Christ, yeah. Teaches and all of those guys. So when Jonah came into the kingdom, he wanted a song and he started to write this song and he said, Patrick, come. And he came to my apartment and we sat down and within 20 minutes, the song was finished and and that was Jonah's first gospel hit song and it's Healing Me,
yeah.
You know, which was kind of really different from what I'm used to, because my thing are reggae.
Yes.
And Juna come with this thing.
The ballad thing.
Yeah, I would do that. Take the Lord in your Life, that was written while I was in high school. That became one of Change's big songs. I think I did one for Sandra Brooks, Robert and Jenny, Sons and Daughters. I rearrange and rewrite. I Rather Have Jesus, which is a traditional song. I put a little DJ thing to it. That was big. It was used in a soundtrack in a One Love movie. Yeah, I remember when the guys came and they heard the song, you know, the choir sound with this reggae thing, they were like, wow. So it was on that soundtrack. And I did some other songs. I wrote a few songs for Felter when they had a big. Some of the big campaigns, Banyo Belly and Ball.
Yeah.
Yes, that was my song. And some other ones. The 25th anniversary song. I wrote a 25th anniversary song for Vaz Prep. The 60th anniversary, and to hear the kids sing that song, it was just awesome. And I just changed 60 to 65 years recently, and awesome. Yeah, I remember.
Right. Listen, man, I hope all of your registration, as I'm saying, with all of your things, them sort out in a Virgin, because you're supposed to have about $30 billion in the right?
I wish. I wish. You know?
Now, let me delve into your artwork, man.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I at the top of the show, I said it. Absolutely amazing, stunning. And what I saw when I came in, I thought was pencil, but you told me you did all this in pen.
It's pen, yeah. It's a pen, rapidograph. It's a special pen.
Yeah.
It's a very fine point. I can show you after. But the discipline and the patience and the end product is what drives me.
Yeah.
And I used to work in advertising as a graphic artist, maybe 25 years and stuff. So the precision and accuracy and all of those things. And I love art. And art and music is my true passion in life.
Yes.
And for years, like, I couldn't decide which one I would choose. And I, you know, if I'm given the opportunity to choose this, you know, have to choose this day,
yes,
type of thing. And, you know, lots of thought. And I say, you know, really art, because I don't need anybody else to do the art.
Indeed.
Yeah, so if I, you know, write the music and I wear everything in my head, but we need people.
To bring it to life.
Yes, but art, I just get
you up. You and your pencil and your pen.
Yes, and we work till 2-3 o'clock in the morning. And me, all right.
and you've done renditions for Usain Bolt, Shelly-Ann Fraser Price, pretty much all our athletic stars.
Yeah, because I'm an athletic fan.
Yes.
Love sports, but in athletics. I was an athlete in my high school days.
Oh, yeah, so.
Yeah, man, I did hurdles at tramps.
You serious?
Yeah, man, I'm come third and thing.
What a magic.
I played Manning Cup with, you know, I played Manning Cup at high school. I captained both the track team, the football team. I played table tennis. And
enough people never know them things about you, know, Patrick.
Oh,
I tell you now,
yes.
Everybody jump up and up in their life now.
Yes.
But you like to do a lot of portraits, though.
Well, the human figure, the portrait, yes, because you can capture the resemblance, and that is always a challenge for me, you know. So if you do a portrait for you, but make sure, say, nobody
it
not
look like
ask
me.
Yes, or you, and you feel like it won't come off of the paper. And when you're looking at the eyes, you say, yeah. So, yeah, the portrait and stuff, and some challenging pieces, but yeah, all right. I'm going to decide if I turn it up now.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is what you do full time?
It seems so, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes. Always into art. And then when I left advertising, I just decided to do it full time. I don't know if full time, but I do it.
Yeah.
Most of my time.
Anybody want a quality production? Call Patrick Kitson.
Oh yes, if you want a portrait that you're not going to regret and it will be in your family as long as...
For generations.
Yes.
Yes,
sir. I are the one.
Well, I can tell you, you are the one indeed. Yeah, that's right. And this is the place if you need something stunning to be done. And I'm talking about the imagery is exceptional, from shadows and light angles, you name it. The details, the depth of perception, it's captured in every image that we have here. And we're going to show you some of them as we you know, take our leave of the great Patrick Kitson with the Eric Clapton guitar. You understand? Patrick, it's a pleasure, man.
Respect,
it's a
man.
Real
respect,
pleasure
man.
Sharing
respect,
with
man.
You. Yeah, but we're having part two still.
It feels so.
Yeah, man. I'm a visa boy. I wouldn't scratch the surface yet.
No.
Yes.
A lot, it's a lot.
I'm
it's
telling
a
you,
lot. It's
there's a whole lot of history that you have to share, and definitely we'd love to have a part two with you, man.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man. That's it for us here on An Octave Higher, you know, in the personal space, the creative environment of the man, Patrick Kitson. And may I tell you, I feel like, oh, I'm going to get my phone checked. I'll probably try and draw myself, you know, but I hope we drew the right kind of picture for you today. And definitely we're looking forward to sharing with you even more inside an octave higher. So join me next time, man. I'm your host, Omar Travis.